Hello, and welcome back to Anointed Fire. My name is Tiffany Buckner, and today's question is, when will it be my season? The average single woman wants to know, when will it be her season to be found by her God-appointed husband? The average single man wants to know, when will it be his season to find his God-appointed wife? The average person wants to know, when will it be their season to walk into the blessings that God has laid on their heart, that He has set aside for them, or those blessings that the prophet has stopped him and said, God said is your season. God says He's going to do this for you and He's going to do that for you. You know, a lot of us have received prophetic words about these huge blessings that God is going to give us. And of course, we are excited about it and we want those things to come to pass. But the question of the hour is, when will it come to pass? When will it be my season? The thing that I want you to understand, and today what I'm going to be helping you to understand, when the way that seasons work. Now, if you click off of this recording because you want to hear more about the details of what you got to do, then like I always tell women and guys, but this is mainly a woman thing, it's a female thing. A lot of women have a problem with being so focused on having a man and wanting to be in a relationship with a man that they go off course with God, and they sit there and they want to hear messages about, okay, what should I do to make things happen faster? How can I fast forward the seasons? How can I go around the seasons? What can I do to make God say, well, you know what? I see that you're a little bit more anxious than the rest, so let me go ahead and release your husband to you. So a lot of women actually delay their God-appointed husbands from finding them because they are making an idol out of the idea of marriage. I'm going to touch on that, but I really want you to understand that seasons play out the way that they play out, you know, the way God has designed them to play out. It's not going to play out any faster just because you're desperate. It's not going to play out any faster just because you're crying and you're about to give up or you feel like you're going to go back into sin. If you are threatening God and you're telling Him that you feel like you're going to go back into sin, and you know, people try to do that passive aggressively. They don't tell God directly. Some people are foolish enough to do that, but some people will talk to other people and say, I feel like I'm giving up, and you know, I feel like sin is just better for me, or what have you. That's passive aggressively threatening God. It doesn't work. It only sets you back. It only reveals the motives of your heart. It just shows that you're not in the wait for the right reason. You're not about God you've already made, you know, being in a relationship or whatever it is that you're waiting on, an idol. And that is the very reason you probably haven't gotten that thing yet. So we're gonna talk about that today. But first and foremost, I want to tell you about a conference call that I have that I'm going to be hosting tomorrow, Monday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It's going to be on unforgiveness and debt. I want y'all to hear me, and I want you to hear me clearly. Even if you think you have forgiven the people who've hurt you, come on the line anyway. I don't care if you think that, you know, I've been nice to the guy, so that must mean I've forgiven him, or I've been nice to the girl, so that must mean I've forgiven her. Come on to the line anyhow. I want to tell you this before I go into the information about the call. One of the biggest issues with a lot of believers, especially those who say, I want my God-appointed husband, I want my God-appointed wife. You know, I've noticed I can put up a recording, and I love y'all enough to tell you the truth, but I can put up a recording and say the season to be found by your God-appointed husband. If I say anything about a man, I'm going to get a whole lot of views. If I say something about forgiveness, rejection, or anything that may be holding you back, a lot of people don't come out and listen to that because they don't think that that's their problem. They think that, well, you know, that's not my issue, so I don't need to listen. So they listen to more ministry about a husband, a man, a woman, you know, a relationship, riches. They chase up behind prophets looking for a word about the, you know, receiving things. This is the error that's in the church. A lot of people want to receive a harvest, but they don't understand that there is a season that you're supposed to be sowing as well. They don't understand that. So one of the questions I like to pose to people is, if God gives you tomorrow, let's say if He looks back over the course of the last 6 months, over the last year, and He says, I'm about to give you what you've sown. You're about to reap what you have sown in the last 6 months or the last year. Would you be scared or would you be happy? And I want you to answer that question truthfully within your heart. Would you be scared or would you be happy? See, that helps you to understand where you are in Christ Jesus. You know, and I understand that a lot of us could have repented by then and we're doing, you know, good things and we've turned around in the last 3 months to 6 months, but the average person hasn't turned around or hasn't turned around that much. They haven't made a complete turn. They're just sitting back and they're going back and forth between God and the world. They're going between God and whatever lust that they're bound by. So if I was to tell you, or if God was to come out and say that you are about to reap what you've sown in the last 6 months, would you be excited or would you be scared? Y'all, let me tell you, I would actually be excited. Because I know what I've sown. I know what I put out there. I know that, and I'm not saying that I've been perfect, but I am saying that I know my heart has been in Christ Jesus. I am saying that I have been intentional with my lifestyle, with, you know, the choices that I make, with even how I treat people. Within the last few years, I have been intentional with, you know, my love and making sure that I release people as soon as they offend me. I have been intentional. So I wouldn't be afraid to receive whatever it is that I've sown. Now, there are some things I've sown, like, you know, I turn around and I may get frustrated with somebody and I feel like I don't want to deal with this person anymore or deal with that person anymore. I can say within the last couple of years, I have shut a lot of doors. And that is because for me, I don't like drama. You know, that's my thing. I don't like drama. I do believe that God brings people into your life. And there's a season for those people to be in your life. And you can always tell when that season ends, when there's a lot of drama coming through that door. Because the Bible says where there is strife, there is every evil work. So when I start seeing strife, I understand that it is time to close that door. But I do understand, too, that when you get married, you got to have long suffering and patience. So you can't close that door. That's not something you can just get up and say, hey, well, you know, I'm tired or what have you. You have to actually work through that one. So in that area, I can say, you know, if God was to say, well, I'm going to send a husband and you're going to reap how you've been closing doors, I'd be like, no, Lord, I don't want that. So, but I do believe that anytime I close the door, I do believe that it has been God, because I don't close doors quick. I pray about them. So anyhow, if God was to come out and say to you, you are about to reap what you have sown in the last 6 months to a year, would you be happy or would you be scared? Would you be repenting and fasting? Or would you be rejoicing? That is a question that a lot of people need to ask themselves. And honestly, be truthful with yourself, because the average person won't be truthful. You know, when we get into the church, I've learned that we go through seasons, especially when we get saved and we're starting to grow up. There's a season I've learned. I know in my own personal walk, I went through a season of religiousness. I went through a season of going to church and performing a bunch of works and doing everything that I thought I was supposed to do, but I didn't have the right heart. You know, if you came and you brushed up against me the wrong way or said something to me out the side of your mouth or what have you, then you would see what was in my heart come out. And that was a season where I thought that, well, all I have to do is just go to God and tell him, well, I apologize, I know, but you know what, God, this man or this woman provoked me or what have you. That was a season when I had a lot of strife in me, and I didn't understand then that I needed to take that stuff to God. I didn't understand then that sometimes God will allow people to rub you the wrong way so that what's on the inside of you can manifest and you can turn around and get delivered from it. See, a lot of times we think the offense is us reacting, but the offense is what's on the inside of your heart. What's on the, you know, what do you have the potential to do? What's there? It's already there. God had to deal with me a lot of times about that, because in the beginning, like the average religious person, I thought it was what I did or what I said that got me in trouble. And of course, that can get you in trouble too. But it was what was in my heart. That's what I had to get delivered from. I had to get to the point where I could walk out and I can be at the store, for example, and a woman can pass by me and barely, you know, just have no respect and cut me off with her shopping cart, go where I'm, and she just full of hell and unforgiveness. And I see all that in her and she just being nasty. And I got to the point where I had to get to the point where that didn't affect me. If anything, I learned to smile, walk around her, get whatever it is that I want, or come back to the aisle at a different time. And one thing I've noticed is that by doing that, sometimes what you do is you provoke something on the inside of the person, but not in the wrong way. You provoke conviction onto a person. So whenever a person is walking out and they got hell in them, they're actually looking for a response. So we're going to be talking about that tomorrow on the conference call about debt and unforgiveness. It's not going to be just debt with unforgiveness. We're going to be talking about your money tomorrow too. And I'm going to show you how that ties into unforgiveness. So y'all want to be on this call. this is going to be a recorded call, so it won't be a public call, meaning I'm not going to be putting the call-in information out. If you want the call-in information, if you made a purchase through SelFi, then I already have your email address locked in on SelFi. SelFi stores the email addresses of everyone who has ever made a purchase. Look, I don't care if y'all go in there and buy something for 99 cents. It doesn't matter. Come on to the call. The reason is not going to be a public call for those of you who are questioning why. The reason it's not going to be a public call is because whenever you have a public call, you can't really record it because you're going to have trolls online, guaranteed. You're going to have trolls, especially with the number of people that listen and come out to the calls. You're going to have trolls on the call. You're going to have somebody who has a demon in them, and they're going to come on to the call because the devil tells them to do so. And they're going to want to play games, dial numbers, and act crazy. And of course, I can mute the call, but we're going to unmute it to do the question and answering segment. We wouldn't be able to do the question and answering segment if I open it up to the public, because guaranteed we will have a troll on the line. But one thing about a troll, I've always said this about people, is if you want to control a call, if you want to make sure that you don't have to deal with a troll will listen to their demons on a lot of things. But one thing that demon can't do is make their troll spend money. Reason is that person a lot of times has a deeper relationship with their money than they do with their demon. So that demon can sit there and talk and, you know, tell them all these things. But whenever you start talking about money or what have you, they're not going to pay to come clown, knowing that they're going to probably be hung up on, or they're not going to pay to come clown on the line. They'll pay to do a lot of things, but they're not going to pay for something that's not going to benefit them. You know, whenever they come onto a line, it's just because it's free and they get to come on there, and for them it's humor. They don't have anything else to do. So it's going to be a controlled call. Our last call, we had over 200 callers. Excuse me. Our last call, I believe tomorrow we may have over 200 callers, but our last call, we had 164 callers. And this was just for me advertising through SelFi, me using the people who came onto SelFi and made a purchase, me sending out emails to those of you. And we had 164 people on the call, and that call turned out to be powerful. It turned out to be blessed. It went on for 6 hours. However, tomorrow's call, y'all, I love you, but we're not going to do 6 hours. I am going to open up the floor for questioning, just like I did the last call. We're going to do an hour teaching, and then I'm going to answer your questions or what have you, and then we're going to get off the line. So if you come on and you get the teaching for an hour, and then after the hour goes and we go into the question and answer segment, if you don't want to listen to the question and answer segment, you don't have to. You can hang up the call. If you don't want to come on to the call, but you want to come on to the question and answer segment, then you have totally missed out. I've had people to do that. They want to only do the answers and stuff because they got a specific question. And I'm going to tell y'all, I really wish I could reach the hearts of so many of you, because I've learned, and this is something God has shown me with so many believers, is that you only want what you want. You only have it in your head that I want my husband, I want my wife, I want that great job, I want this and I want that. But you don't know that there are a lot of layers to why you may not be getting the things that you've been asking for in this season. Unforgiveness may be one of them. Rejection may be one of them. It may be something that's going on with you. It could be your friends. It could be something that you're doing. But when somebody comes out and teaches on that, you don't come because you don't think it is related to you, and you don't want to hear anything about having to work or make a change. Only thing you want to hear is about, you know, how do I go out and do these things? How do I get my husband? What do I need to do? You know, do I need to dress a certain way? Do I need to go out here or go out there? What do I need to do? That era in thinking is why a lot of witchcraft churches are so popular. Because a witchcraft church is going to tell you what you want to hear. You're going to go in there and be bound. Satan likes to catch people by the hem of their lust. You know, whenever you got a lust, lust is something that you want that's out of order. It's something that you desire that is out of order. Anytime you desire sex and you're not married, then that is lust trying to fill up in your bones. Lust is more than a desire. It's a strong desire. It's a stronghold. It's something that you want more than you want God. It's something that you want more than you want anything. And a lot of people have made the idea of getting married or even being rich a stronghold. And that's why whenever I do a message on how to get a man, I get a lot of hits. But if I do a message on how to improve your finances or how to get past this or that, you don't get as many hits, because you got a lot of people who think that they can get around God. And I'm going to tell y'all, I used to be bound by that thinking. And one thing I tell people all the time when I'm coaching people, and I'm telling y'all, when I'm coaching or when I'm dealing one-on-one, if I'm just ministering, it doesn't matter. I tell people all the time, God had to get me to the point where I just finally stood up and say, the word of God is true. A lot of y'all are not there yet. You're still thinking that there has to be another way. There has to be something else that I can do. Well, I understand all that, but you got to understand the particulars of my situation. You got to understand I've done this for so many years. I have been the secretary of my church. I have served my pastor faithfully. Yeah, but have you served God faithfully? I've sat up here and I've been pure. You know, I haven't had sex for 12 years. Okay, but have you been pure in your heart for 12 years? Are you forsaking ungodly communication? Do y'all understand that having ungodly communication is just as bad as having premarital sex? You sitting up there hanging around people that God don't want you to, you are joining up to them in an ungodly soul tie as well. A lot of people walk around with their legs closed, which is a good thing. Praise God. But they still got a bunch of ungodly communication. And they sit there and they say, I don't know why it's taking God so long. It ain't taking God long. Problem is, he looks at you and he looks at their heart and he sees all those ties. He sees all these people linked to your heart, and he looks around and he sees darkness attached to you. And he said, I'm not sending my son, my faithful son, this man who's been praying to me, fasting. I'm not sending him into that place. I'm not sending him into that relationship with you. So he have to deal with you and the folks that you constantly dealing with. So God says, okay, what are we going to do? I'm going to wait. I'm going to let you wait it out. And you're going to have to go through deliverance with these people until you get it in your mind that the word of God is true. That I cannot hang out with ungodly people. It doesn't matter if they're family or friends. It doesn't matter how much money they gave you when you were down or how they've been there for you. It doesn't matter. Ungodly communications will always ruin you. So let's go into this whole season's talk. A lot of you, you're saying, God, where is my God-appointed husband? I want to know where my husband is. I love him, and I've been praying for him, and I've been praying for him, and I've been doing this, and I've been doing that. Or you're saying, where's my God-appointed wife? Or even if it's not your wife, you're asking for your blessings. Maybe you're asking for your God-appointed friendships. You know, a lot of us, I've learned that God put a lot of us in seasons where we're kind of alone. We don't have that many people around us, and we want those God-appointed friendships where we can have people that are attached to us who are as loyal as we are. A lot of us want that. And because we ask for that, we think that, okay, so next person I meet who's nice must be my God-appointed friend, when it's not the case. The enemy, sometimes he'll intercept your prayers and he'll, you know, send somebody into your life. He'll send a counterfeit, just like he'll send a counterfeit person to pretend to be your husband or your wife. He'll send a counterfeit friend. He'll send somebody into your life who's in church, who says, I love the Lord, or what have you. And that person will be completely demonic. That person will be on assignment from the enemy to really just get information out of you to see what God is doing in your life so that they can go and pray against you, or the jealousy in them can work against the blessing on your life. Because you got to understand one thing about jealousy is bordering witchcraft. So a person that deals with jealousy, a lot of times they're going to look for errors in you. They'll listen to you talk about blessings and things that God has done or you're wishing for God to do. And then when they hang up from you, a lot of times they'll go pray and they'll say, well, God, you're doing all of this for her, and I don't understand because I've been doing this. And then they'll talk to their other friends and say, you know, and she's over there talking about this or what have you. Yeah, man, girl, please, that girl ain't finna get this. So you got this person who's speaking these things into the atmosphere. You giving her what she needs to do, or you giving her your secrets. You giving her the very things that you've been giving to God, your intimate prayers. You're telling them to her, and or you're telling them to him. And that person is speaking against them. And, you know, a lot of times when you're dealing with a person like that, especially if they're in church, they don't know that they're in error. They don't know that they're in witchcraft. Oftentimes what they think is that, well, I just got frustrated. You know, you got to understand my situation. I just got mad. But they don't know that every time they come into a person's life, the enemy uses them to speak against that person. And people like that have a tendency to be drawn to ungodly people. They're drawn to people that they can call up on the phone and gossip, you know, too. They're drawn to people like that. And they also drawn to people who are in the church, people who are walking in holiness and stuff, because in their initial, the initial thing that draws them is the fact that they're kind of fascinated with your life. They're just like, wow, you know, you're doing all that, man. It's something about you that's special. But when they get up on you, then what's on the inside of them is activated. That jealousy is activated. Every ungodly thing in them is activated. And then they start the very thing that they do with everybody else. And one thing God taught me was that he said, be very careful with your friends. He said, because not everybody can be close to you, because not everybody can understand you. So you put a person in danger by being close to them, especially if you start revealing things to them. Because what ends up happening is if you're revealing it to the wrong person, that person is going to start rising up against you, which means they're rising up against my will for you, which means that they are rising up against me, which means I now have to deal with them. So sometimes, you know, we bring people and we get them in trouble by bringing them close to us because we don't understand that we are anointed. And he said, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. He wasn't just talking to the world. He was talking to the church. He was saying, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. So I got people that are in my family and people who used to be my friend that I can't talk to. And the reason I can't talk to them is because they got gossiping spirits, because they got problems with watching people get blessed. They don't know how to be happy for anybody. And then they'll end up getting into witchcraft. It doesn't matter how many times they go to church and how hard they dance around the church. They'll end up getting into witchcraft because they don't understand what God is doing in my life. And at the same time, one of the things I hate about jealousy is a lot of people turn around and they get jealous of what God has done for you. But my question is this. Would you like to walk in my shoes to get what I got? If you don't want to walk in my shoes, then sit down somewhere. I always tell people, you know, when they say, well, you know, I ain't gonna lie. I felt a little jealousy toward you or what have you. Oh, I feel a little jealousy toward this person. You're not being fair because you're saying that I want what God has done for you without having to pay the price. That's like walking up to somebody who has a job and this person has been working their tail off and they going in there and they putting out all of these hours of sweat, having to go to work when they don't feel like it, going to work when they sick and they finally get a paycheck and you walk up to them and you look at their paycheck and say, that's not fair. But yet still, you've been laying on your couch watching TV and the only trials you've been going through is having to watch your favorite show be canceled for the night or having to watch, you know, one of your favorite actresses and her scene, she gets killed off. That's your trial. Or every once in a while you deal with a hiccup in your life, but you're not having to deal with what that person is going through when they go to work at a 9 to 5, 7 days a week or 5 days a week. You're not having to go through that. That's what jealousy looks like, is you're looking at what somebody else has, but you're not looking at what they've gone through. And I tell people like this, how about I say this prayer? I say, God, everybody who's jealous of me, give them my testimony. See, that'll scare the mess out of a lot of people because they couldn't handle it. A lot of people would have died if they had to walk in my shoes. And I'm not just saying that. A lot of people would not have made it through the first year if they had to walk in my shoes. But the reality is you got a lot of people who will look at your testimony and say, I want your blessings, but I don't want to go through your test. I want your testimony, but I don't want your test. I want all of what you have, but I don't want to go through what you've gone through. That's why I can't stand when I see somebody talking about, you know, she got her God-appointed husband and how she got found so fast or what happened. You don't know her testimony. You don't know what this woman had to sacrifice in order for her to be found. All you know is that you've been waiting for 12 years and she only waited for 2 years, for example. And she got found in 2 years, but you don't know what she sacrificed in those 2 years. 9 times out of 10, she sacrificed more in those 2 years than you were willing to do in those 12. You still hanging out with your kin folks that God been told you a long time ago to get away from. You still hanging around people that God told you not to be associated with. You're still walking with darkness and you still think that the word of God does not apply to you in that area because you're going to find some type of way to justify it. That's what the enemy does. He'll tell you, well, this is different. You know, that's how he did me. I'm going to be honest with y'all. That's how he did me because I didn't know any better. He said, this is different. You know, Tiffany, you went through so much rejection in your life. How dare you reject another person? So I ended up getting married twice outside the will of God because I was still a babe in Christ and I didn't know any better. And I was too busy trying not to be like everybody else. I didn't want to be like those judgmental Christians. And of course, I still don't want to be like the judgmental Christians. But at the same time, I didn't know the difference between a judgmental Christian and a discerning Christian. So I just saw all of them as one, you know, person or one group. That's the judgmental Christians. I didn't want to judge anybody because what I knew was that God changed me and he could change anybody. But I didn't realize that he only changes those who want to be changed, those who are willing to pay the price, those who are willing to make the necessary sacrifices. I didn't understand that. See, I went into both marriages with my heart oh God, I want to make these sacrifices. I want to be a better person. But I was still a babe. And when you're a babe, you're still struggling with what you know versus what God is teaching you. And the more God teaches you, the more you're going to step out of those seasons that you were in. And you're going to find yourself stepping away from relationships and friendships. And you're going to find yourself stepping away from so many things, old mindsets. And God is going to give you something new. And I understand when he said, be thou changed by the renewing of your mind. It's amazing because when he said renewing, I didn't pay attention to the word new. I didn't understand that when he said he was going to renew your mind, that everything around you changes. Even your friends change. I have watched God strip me away from so many different things over the years that it's amazing to me. But I understand that this is a part of the process, not to get me to my God-appointed husband. He's just a stop along the way, but to get me to where he's designed me to be, because I'm a purpose-filled creature and I have an assignment on this earth, and so do you. So when does your season start? When will it be your season to get your God-appointed husband, or to find your God-appointed wife, or to get the blessings that God has set aside for you? First and foremost, you need to understand seasons. A lot of us, we understand, you know, like I said, we understand it when it comes to the natural things. We understand that we got spring, we have summer, we have fall, and we have winter. We understand that. We understand that we got to sow in certain seasons in order to reap in the next season when it comes to the natural. And we talk about a lot of things in the church, but I'm going to tell you what happened with a lot of us is that we became religious and we didn't move past that stage. When I came into the body of Christ, I went into that stage of religiousness. And I think that's a part of the growing Christian. And that's a part when you don't really have understanding. That's when you get stuck between, I want to do right, but I don't have understanding. And when you get to that place, a lot of times you start performing a bunch of works trying to move God. When you get to that place, you start, you know, just trying to do things that you think is going to please God. And at the same time, when you do wrong, you think that going to church on Sunday is like a shower to wash all that wrong off of you. So a lot of people, when they get to that stage, they get stuck. You got to move past that stage. You got to get into the Word of God to the point where you can actually say the Word of God is true. It took me 2 marriages, y'all, to get to that point. Because when I got married the first time, I had just gotten into the church. I was coming out the world. I'm talking about a wild child in the world. I had just gotten to the point where I was starting to go to church. And I got married when I was in that mindset. Well, I know my heart and I'm a good person. And, you know I'm going to be good to my husband. And at the same time, everybody has a tendency to judge, but I'm not going to judge him because I understand him. And I got married and God had to show me that the Word of God is true. He brought me back to it. You know, I was even unequally yoked then, even though I was a babe, I was still unequally yoked with the man that I chose because he wasn't in church and had no desire to go. Then I turned around and I had grown up. We were married for 7 years. I had grown up while I was married to him, but I wasn't a complete adult Christian. I always say I was a teenager. I was still at that rebellious stage. I was still at that stage where I was kind of testing the Word of God. I didn't believe it all the way. I always thought that there was a way around it. Like, that doesn't apply to me. It couldn't apply to me because God couldn't be that unmerciful to make me have to die in that area too. Come on, I done died over here and there. You mean to tell me I got to come over here and die too? I got all these areas you want me to die in, and it looks overwhelming. It looks like you can't do it. And I got to that place and I said to myself, well, my first husband, he wasn't that bad of a person. You know, he just had problems in this area and that area. And I know I was a good wife. So all I need is a guy who doesn't have problems in those areas. And that's what I was looking for. And I got married again to a man who was not in Christ Jesus because I did not accept at that time that the Word of God is true and there is no getting around it. I didn't accept it at that time. But when I got into that marriage within that first year, God said, I'm about to bring you up out of this. And God woke me up. And I tell people, that is my testimony. It's so beautiful to me how he did it. But he woke me up in that year, that first year of marriage. It's like he just pulled a veil off, all the blinders off. He was just like, I want you to see where you are. I want you to see what you've chosen for yourself. And at the same time, here's your purpose. Have a good day. And I'm going to tell you something. When God gives you your assignment, for those of you who don't know who you are in Christ, that is one hard thing to accept when you are not in the right place. when he hands you your assignment. And for me, my heart had been turned around. I'm sitting there like, I love God and I want to serve him and I want to please him. God, use me in any way you see fit. And I just started letting him use me. I started making all these sacrifices. And, you know, I got this purpose now on the inside of me. And in order for him to give me that purpose, he had to fill a void. Okay, well, that void was the reason I brought that man into my life in the first place. But now that that void is filled, what in the world is he doing here? You know, because he's not adding to me. He's not coming to church. He's not covering me. He's not praying with me or for me. He's not doing what I need him to do. The only thing he's doing is depleting me. He's taking away. He's taking away my joy. He's taking away my peace. I want to focus on the things of God. I tell people all the time, God had me to stay in that marriage for 5 years. In the first year, he woke me up. In the first year, I went through a season of screaming and crying. I tell you, I went through a season where I was just like, get me out of here. I'm sorry. I repent. But he let me stay in that marriage for 5 years. And people say, why didn't you leave? And I always tell people it's because he woke me up. And he made it clear in my heart, don't you walk out of here until I give you the clearance. You're not leaving nothing. You're going to stay right here and you're going to endure because this is what you chose for yourself. Marriage is not something that you can just wake up in and say, okay, I get it now. You're not supposed to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Okay, I get it. You can let me out now. It doesn't work like that. So I had to go through a season and I went through 5 years of just grieving and I went through the stages of grief. And then I got to a point where I started accepting my situation. And I said, you know what? Maybe God is going to leave me here. So I better make the best of it. I better be the best wife that I can be. And that's what I started doing. I started submitting to God and I started submitting to my husband and I started doing whatever God told me to do. And I started walking by faith because I had it in my mind. This is not going to be my reality for the rest of my life. Whether I stay with this man or not, I'm not going to be in this place emotionally. I'm not going to be in this place where I'm sitting back and I'm like, I'm still hungry. I'm not content. I don't know why I feel like this. I'm not fulfilled. I don't understand this. I didn't understand seasons at that time. But then God turned around and let me out again. But by the time he let me out of that, I was a full grown woman in him. Because I spent that marriage in prayer. I spent that marriage meditating, fasting, loving on God. I spent that time just getting to know God all the more, crying out to him, dying to my flesh. Whenever I had these situations, and I'm going to tell you, if you're unequally yoked with a person, you're going to have some situations where your flesh going to want to wake all the way up. And God would tell me to go somewhere basically and die in your flesh. Go over there and die. Go over there and do something nice. Go over here and do this and do that. And I'm sitting there screaming out from the top of my lungs like, I can't do this. And until, like I said, he calmed me down and helped me to understand that, hey, you can sit here and be in this situation and make it harder on yourself. Or you can go and start submitting. And I just started submitting. And I just gave my life completely over to him. And I made it up in my mind and in my heart. I really repented and I said, I will never fornicate again. If I got out of this marriage, God never has to worry about me fornicating again. And he left me in there until I got to the point where I said, I will never even kiss a man again. See, I had to get to the point where I said, the word of God is true. A lot of you are not at that point yet. I can talk to the average believer and tell you that they're not there yet. They're at that place where they think, well, I mean, I understand what you're saying, but even though he ain't saved, he's real good. You know, he's real nice. And then he been taking care of his mama. And then he got custody of his daughter and all this other stuff. Yeah, but he ain't saved. Yeah, but still, you know, he's a good guy. Yeah, but the Bible said don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Yeah, but you know, like I said, he's a good guy. Okay, in your mind, the word of God does not apply to your situation because you've analyzed it and you found that, well, this situation, you know, requires that I be exempt or the guy that I'm courting is exempt. And the word of God exempts no man. Whatever he said, believe it. Whatever he says, do it. I had to get to that point, y'all, where if God says that's not your husband, I had to make sure I back all the way up. No communication. No, you can't call me. No, you cannot do anything. I'm sorry. I can't deal with you any further. I had to get to the point where I believe God. I'm talking about even with friendships, with everybody in my life, ungodly associations, I got to cut them off. I got to the point where I came to understand that in everything God says, there is no lie present. There are no exemptions present. There is no small print that exempts a person. the average person that I find who is in a bad situation. A lot of people reach out to me for counseling. And when I'm talking to them, I want to tell you the most common error that I find is that they're in some area where they don't believe God. It's always that there is some area where they don't yet believe God. They're sitting back and they're going around all of these loops. And it's kind of funny. They'll try to, you know, try to build their case. And I understand if you've ever watched Judge Judy, she's really kind of cutthroat. And she really doesn't like you to go into details because she understands that this person is trying to convince her. They're building a case and she's like, no, give me the facts. Give me the facts. Let me measure it up against the law. This is what the law says. Let's forget all the other stuff. You know, let's cut all this other stuff out. I don't want to hear about all that. Your situation, I understand the particulars. You know, you feel like there are particulars that make you exempt from the law, but it doesn't exist. So she's kind of cutthroat. She makes sure that, hey, you give me, I don't want to hear all that. Well, I went through, see, you got to understand, I went to his house. I don't want to hear all that. It's just like this. What does the law say? Okay, did you pay this money? You paid him that amount of money? Did you have a contractual agreement? So she's really going by the law. She's going by man's law, but she sticks to that law. Y'all, you got to be like that with the word of God. Like, you got to actually be to the point where you locked in, where you say, what does the word of God say? Stop trying to give God particulars. Stop trying to give him all of these different instances that you believe is going to exempt you from the word. Because if you don't, then you're going to continue to go through all of those situations where you're going to be reaching out and saying, I need somebody to talk to. I'm going through this. And then you're going to come on and you're going to start talking. And the minister, if they're in Christ Jesus, they can hear the error. It's in you. But you're going to still be going around, just flying around, constantly trying to go around the word of God. And nobody's going to sit on the phone with you for 3 and 4 hours while you buzz all around the word of God. While you just sit up there and dip in all of these other things. And the man of God or the woman of God has to keep trying to bring you back to the word. Conversation get in 5 minutes if you would accept that the word of God is true. So that's the problem with seasons right now, is people don't understand that the seasons in the natural are similar to the seasons of the spirit. You got to come to understand that the seasons of the spirit mean that I have to sow and then I reap. I have to sow and then I reap. But between sowing and reaping, there's a time of waiting. There's a season that I need to water. I need to plant and I need to water. I need to plant and I need to be connected to the right people so they can water. And I got to be watering somebody else's stuff too. Because that's what God said. One man planted, another more man waters, but God brings an increase. So I got to understand that it ain't just about me. It is not just I'm going to come over here and plant and God's going to connect me to the right people and they're going to come in because I'm so special and they're going to come in and water all of my stuff. And then the season's going to come around. And because I kept, you know, my legs closed and because I sat back there and I went to church and I said Christian things, that a season's going to come and everybody gets to watch me get blessed. It doesn't work like that. It sounds right, but it's not right. The way that it works is I got to sow. But I got to be connected to my brothers and sisters in the Lord. So I got to understand where I'm required to sow. I got to make sure I'm sowing into the right place. And I got to have the right attitude with sowing. God said he loves a cheerful giver. So it makes no sense for me to go over here and sow if I'm not happy about it. If I'm doing it grudgingly, if I'm just giving because, you know what, I want God to give me this. So let me go and get this for a person this. Man, these people get on my nerves. I always asking for money. And you going over here and you giving grudgingly. So you might as well keep that money in your pocket because that's your reward. That's what you ask for. That's your God. That's what you're celebrating. That's your source and your resource. You're sitting back and you're praying to God, but you're worshiping the dollar. You got to understand that we got to get to the point where we are sowing and we're watering as well. And then we wait. And here's the thing. Waiting requires patience. A lot of people don't ask for patience. I've heard people say they wouldn't ask for patience. A lot of people, as a matter of fact, said they wouldn't ask for patience because they know what they'll have to go through. I ask for it because I noticed that a lot of those same people that don't ask for patience actually don't have any patience. And when you don't have any patience, you have no long suffering, which means you will go and shoot your own seed in the head. You will set your harvest on fire because you'll get impatient. You'll set your own harvest on fire because you don't understand that patience is tied to your harvest. Patience, I got to have patience. If I plant corn seed, if I want that corn to come up, I got to have patience. Otherwise, I'm going to go out there and I'm going to keep pulling up up the seed. I'm going to complain. I'm not going to water because I'm going to say I put enough water in that plant. Why that plant ain't coming up? I'm tired. I'm not putting no more water in that plant because I don't have the patience needed. But if I get the patience, I get the understanding. That's one thing you got to understand about patience. It comes with understanding. You will not get understanding without patience. If you're sitting back and you're saying, I'm going to pray for God to give me the stuff, but I ain't going to ask him for patience because I don't want to go through that stuff, then what you're basically saying is you don't want understanding. You just want the harvest. And it doesn't work that way. God's not going to give you something that you don't understand. You know, it's the same thing for you. Would you give a 3-year-old a microwave knowing good and well that 3-year-old doesn't understand that microwave? He'll blow your house up. And you know it. So you're not going to give something to a child that child cannot work and cannot understand. You're going to wait for him to grow up some. And then you'll say, hey, there's a microwave in the kitchen. Here's how to work it. And when he demonstrates that he understands, I cannot put metal in his microwave and I can't put these type of foods in the microwave because it'll dry them out. And I shouldn't microwave everything because there's radiation in there. When he gets to the point that he can understand that, then you will trust him with the microwave. But if he doesn't get to that point, then you're not going to get a microwave. Or you're going to make sure that he's restricted from the microwave. God works the same way, y'all. Whenever you're asking God for something, one of the things you need to ask him for is patience so that you don't go out there and set your own seed on fire. I asked God for patience, and I did. I went through some trials. I really did. I went through some stuff, and it was to get me to the patience, but I came to understand it wasn't so much the trial. The issue was me not being patient in the trial. So me in the midst of that trial, me wanting it to be over with, me wanting to go straight into the blessing, that was the issue. So in the midst of the trial, I had to learn to ask God for his mercy and his grace, and I asked him to loan me his patience until mine was built up. In the midst of the trial, I had to sit there and just deal with what I was going through and understand that if I stopped it, because I'm going to tell y'all, you can stop a trial. But sometimes you're not supposed to, because there are some things that you go through because God is trying to get something to you. It's not necessarily an attack from the enemy. It's just God trying to get something to you, and it goes against what you want, or it goes against the process you want to endure. But in the midst of the trial, the best prayer to pray is give me the patience to deal with this. Give me your mercy and your grace. Give me peace. Lord, give me understanding. And when God gives you understanding, you avoid the trial in the future because now you have understanding. And when you have understanding of something, it doesn't bother you. You know, it's kind of like when I used to go skating. When I first started going skating, when I was probably 15, I think, when I first started going. And I had been skating, you know, before then. I had all kinds of skates or what have you. But when I turned 15 years old, I started going to this popular skating rink around town. And when I first went there, you know, I was like, I know how to skate. You know, I can skate on the little basketball courts in my neighborhood and all this other stuff. And I had them inline skates. But, you know, it's kind of hectic because all these people on the floor and they're going by real fast. And you got to try to get out there. It's like trying to get out and rush hour traffic, you know, because we went out on popular nights. But you're trying to get out there and it's kind of intimidating at first. But I came to understand if I want to join in and have some fun, I got to get out there. So guess what? I got my tail out on that floor and I fell a couple of times. I skated slow. I tried to get to the place where, you know, you can let the fast skaters skate around you. And I got to the point until I got confident, and then I became a fast skater and I can go around that ring, you know, pretty fast. I had to get to the point where I was confident as a skater. It was a process. I couldn't get up off the floor and say, well, I fail, so it's not for me. And go and sit down somewhere, or say, you know, it's not fair that she can skate real fast. And I'm looking at her not realizing that she didn't went through the process. She didn't went out there and learned what she needed to learn. She didn't fail however many times she needed to fall in order for her to get to that place. So, I mean, we got to understand this when it comes to seasons. The question is, if God, again, is to say to you, I'm going to give to you right now what you've sown in the last 6 months, would you receive a blessing? Or a spanking? Or a beatdown? That's the question. What would you receive if God was to allow you to reap what you've been sowing? Or would you receive God throwing a bunch of idols back at you? You know, pictures in your mind of men and marriage and children and all these other things, but there is no picture of him on the walls of your heart. Not one picture of him. I've come to understand that a relationship with God is the most important relationship that anybody can have. And most people in the church say, I have a relationship with him. But talk to him on the phone. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. They're going to speak more about getting a man than anything. You know, they're going to speak more about who hurt them or what they've been through than anything to do with God. And that's because most people have a religious relationship with God. Most people have a vicarious relationship with God through their pastor. And some people have an invisible relationship with God. You kind of like if you meet that person who has a mental deficit, we'll say, and they think that they're in a relationship with another person, and you meet the other person and you say, "Hey, I met your girlfriend the other day." And he's like, "Who?" And you say, for example, "Sharon. Sharon, she told me about you." And he's like, I don't know no Sharon. "Yeah, she goes to your church." "Oh, that crazy girl? Man, no, that girl be staring at me all the time. Ain't none of my girlfriend. She told you she's my girlfriend." This girl has an invisible relationship. She's entertained it in her mind, and that girl needs some major deliverance. She also needs understanding, because deliverance don't stick unless you have understanding. She'll go back out there and entertain those demons again, because what they'll do is come back wherever she has a void, wherever she's void of understanding, they'll come back in and they'll start to, you know, give her all these ideas and then make her feel good and kind of tickle her ears. And then she gets back to that point where she's saying, "Well, you know, I tried, but I know he's my guy. And like, you know, he looks at me a certain way, and I know we're meant to be together." And you can't reach that child. That child needs some full-blown deliverance. She really needs to sit in the midst. Like, you have some people that have to go to an asylum. She really needs to sit under anointing for a while. Like, we need some buildings that are just completely full of the anointing, that you don't go home from, that you just sit in there and read the word of God and get understanding. But one thing, like I said, one thing about God is he wants us to get to that point where we say the word of God is true. So in order for you to receive, ladies, your God-appointed husband, guys, your God-appointed wife, people, whatever it is that God has assigned to your life, the thing that I've learned that you have to do is seek ye first the kingdom of God. We hear it all the time, but most people hear it religiously. You know, how many of you dropped your head when I said that? "Oh man, you said the same thing. No, tell me something. Tell me, you know, do I go out and put a leaf on the side of my jacket and I make sure that I wriggle that leaf anytime I pass by a woman? What am I supposed to do?" That's what people are wanting to hear. But the reality is, God is seeking a relationship with you so that you don't go out here and make an idol out of a person. Because if you don't have that relationship with God, that intimate, fulfilling relationship with God, where he can get into your heart and rearrange some things and fill those voids and cut away all of that uncircumcised flesh. If you don't have that relationship with him, then God cannot send your spouse to you, and he's not going to release blessings to you, because you can't hold on to that stuff. That flesh of yours and that mindset of yours is what's keeping you away from him, is what's making you not want to have an intimate relationship with him. Like I said, you have to get to the point where you can say passionately, without a shadow of a doubt, that the word of God is true. Because whatever a man soweth, it is that he shall reap. If you sow a relationship with God, you will reap a relationship with God, and you'll reap those God-ordained relationships that you've been praying for, like those God-ordained friendships. You know, you cannot ask God for a God-ordained friendship when you are not completely following God, when you're not submitting to God, because you're only going to lead these people astray, and God's not going to put those people in your life. He's not going to send somebody into your life for you to lead them astray. It's not about, "Well, put me around the right people and I'll get right." It doesn't work like that. It's all about your intimate time with God, what you do alone. Look, it's hard at first, I understand, but do it. Spend time alone. Doesn't matter how crazy you feel, in your own room talking to God and praying to him. You know, the enemy is going to try to make you feel silly at first. Doesn't matter how silly you feel. Make sure you spend that time with God and tell him where you need to be delivered. Tell him and get to know him. Read his word. Get to know him. Don't focus on a man. Don't sit there and say in your heart, "Well, I'm doing all this because I want my man." When you're doing that, God sees a person sitting there with an idol in their heart. And they're saying, "Okay, I'm going to sit, you know, and I'm going to talk to you until you hand me my Buddha statue." That's what you're saying. Hand me the very thing that I've been worshiping. Until you hand me, you know, all of the treasures and the things of this world, I'm just going to sit in your midst and pretend that I like you. How many of us can't stand people to come around us like that? How many of us can't stand when we get those friends and people who come and they get around us and the only thing they want to do is try to reach into our pockets and, you know, try to pull out of our lives, trying to use somebody? That's what a lot of people are doing to God. That's what they're doing. They're going and sitting in the midst of God and going to church and hooping and hollering, and they're so faithful to their pastor, and they're doing all this stuff because they want something from God. And I'm going to tell you something. You can't get over on God. It doesn't matter what comes out your mouth. God doesn't pay attention to that. God looks straight at the heart. Has to match what's coming out of your mouth. Otherwise, you are a liar. God is not going to sit there and say, oh my God, did she just say she loved me? I'm so flattered. He's not a man. He understands when you're lying. He understands when you're just saying things because you believe it religiously, because you've told yourself for so long that I do love him. I really do. I go to church and all. It's kind of like, you know, how we laugh at people who say, well, you know, I'm not racist. I got black friends. Or people who say, I'm not racist. I got white friends. Doesn't mean that you're not racist. It just means that you've learned to tolerate people. You're trying to force yourself to tolerate people. It's kind of like if you get somebody who's scared of snakes and they sit there and hold a snake, doesn't mean that they're not afraid of snakes. It just means that they have taken a chance at that moment to hold a snake. It doesn't matter if you bring that snake back to them several times and they agree to hold it. They still have that fear, and you'll notice that they're cringing and holding that snake off from a distance. That's what people are doing in what they call these relationships with God. You see, I'm sitting in church. You know, I went to church Sunday. I've been going to church for the last 12 years. But you've been sitting in church and you're an unchanged creature. You know, when God looks out there, he wants to look at somebody who's different, who's changed. He wants to look at a person who's progressing. If you're not progressing in your church, then you might need to go to another church. If you're not progressing where you are, if you're sitting there, you're still struggling with the same demons you've been struggling with for years, you definitely need to go to another church. If you're dealing with the same strongholds that you've been dealing with for years, you need to go to another church. So the thing is, it's not about going into a church building. It's not about what you say. It's not about, okay, so I've made some sacrifices. I've kicked like three guys to the curb just to prove my love for God. God says, okay, let's take it a step further. Prove your love now. When that man comes into your life who the devil well dresses, this man comes in and he's dressed up the way that you want your man. Half of the women fail that test. I'm telling you right now, half of the women, when that Ishmael comes into their life and he's well dressed and he comes up and he says, praise the Lord, they fail that test. Some of them don't even have to say praise the Lord. They sitting up there playing Tupac in their car, walking around cursing, do-rags on their head or what have you. If the woman can convince him to come to church with her, it doesn't matter how he dressed. She think that he's the one, and you can't tell her nothing. When a woman gets her mind locked on a man, you can't move her. Only thing you can do is let her go through the test. She has to go marry the guy, get in a relationship, do whatever, have children with the guy, do whatever she gonna do for her to come back and say the word of God is true. A lot of people got to walk off and go into those testimonies and come back out and say the word of God is true. That's why I tell people nowadays, I don't argue with people. You know, one thing about me is if I'm ministering to you, for example, and you go off into a relationship and I'm telling you, hey, you know, that's not from God. This is what God wants for you and all this other stuff. And you like, yeah. And I kind of noticed that you don't really want to talk about that, but you still trying to entertain that relationship. I'm not going to say nothing to you. I'm not going to treat you bad. I'm going to keep loving you. I'm going to sit there. But at the same time, I'm going to stay prayerful too, because I make sure that your relationships ain't going to start affecting me, because sometimes you can go out there and get into a relationship with somebody, be it a romantic relationship or a familiar relationship with a friend or family member. You can get into a relationship and you become an open door in the demonic. And I got to make sure that what's coming through you ain't coming over into my life and attacking me, because you in rebellion, because you want to have ungodly association. Because when you start having ungodly association, you become ungodly association. And when you become ungodly association, I am not going to let you be sitting up there being no open door, bringing the blessings out of my life just because you want to be in rebellion. You can go over there if you want to. You have fun in your rebellion. But one thing I know without a shadow of a doubt, I don't sit there and wish bad on anyone. One thing I know without a shadow of a doubt, you're going to come out and you're going to say the word of God is true. Eventually, you're going to come and say, ain't no getting around it. The word of God is true. I've learned about people is that you got to let them go through their own test and get their own testimonies. You can sit there and testify to them all day. Some people can hear and they'll say, well, you know what? That is what the word of God says. So I'm going to go ahead and do the right thing, and they'll follow through with it. And then again, there are some people, they got to go through it. They're so stubborn and their skulls are so thick that they got to go through it on their own. See, I was one of those people. And one thing I learned is that when you're dealing with a person like that, you got to actually let them go out and get a testimony. And you just got to be like, well, you know where to find me when you get your testimony. You come back and say the word of God is true. It's a guarantee. It is not a, if they come back and say it, they're going to come back and say the word of God is true. Whether or not they choose to stay in the sin, they're going to acknowledge that the word of God is true. Every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Every tongue's going to confess that he's right. Every tongue's going to confess that everything that he says in his word is true. You're going to come back and say that the seasons are true. I was supposed to sow. So let's get to the sowing part. A lot of people, it's kind of funny to me how religiousness has really made a lot of people in the church ignorant. And I'm going to tell you what the word ignorant means before somebody gets offended, because a lot of people come on and they get what you're trying to say and they understand it's a teaching. But then you already got somebody who's dealing with the spirit of offense. And they sitting back and they already scrunching up their nose and, you know, what have you. The word ignorant, the root word of ignorant is ignore. It means that information is present, but you've chosen to ignore it. Which means that, and I hate to say this, it means that your stupidity or your foolishness is self-inflicted. You didn't have to be that way. You chose to be that way. You ignored the word of God, even though it's present. There's a Bible in your house. There are churches on your block. There are people that you can reach out to, but you chose to ignore this information and continue on with life as it is. That makes you ignorant, which means I've chosen to be what the Bible calls simple-minded, even though I didn't have to. See, there are some people out there who just don't know, but they don't have those sources available. They can't afford Bibles. They don't have those things, especially in a lot of foreign countries. They don't have those things available to them. So they're in this sin, and it's not because, you know, they're choosing it. It's because that's what they were taught since they were born. And God's going to give them an opportunity. And a lot of them are going to sit back and say, oh yeah, Jesus Christ is Lord. All they need is to hear the gospel. And they'll convert so quick. And they'll be some of the most faithful followers of Christ. But you got folks in the United States of America and a lot of these Western countries. You sit back with a Bible on your nightstand. That thing's still brand new 10 years later. You sit back and you choose to be ignorant. You choose not to get the word of God in you. You choose this. And then when you're attacked, you have no weapon to fight with. So you're sitting back and you're trying to have this vicarious relationship with God through your pastor. So you call your pastor and you're bombarding his call or his line every time you go through a trial. Every time something happened in your life, you on his line talking about, pastor, how you doing? Okay, so I'm going through this and I'm going through that. And after a while, you start noticing he ain't taking your calls no more. You know, in the beginning, he was like, he was answering your calls, but now he started ignoring your calls. So what do? You walking around mad at him. You looking for a new church, not understanding that God is saying, get a relationship with me on your own. You got to have your own relationship with me. He cannot sit back. I'm going to tell y'all, as a pastor, he cannot sit back and take calls from everybody in the congregation who refuses to have an intimate relationship with God. People who have so much on their plate in their schedules that they're saying, well, you know, I got these kids and I got to go to school and I got to go do this and I got to go do that. I'm so busy. The most important thing that you can have is a relationship with God. He cannot sit back and say, well, because I've made time in my schedule for God, I'll sit back and let everybody call me at any given time and talk and talk and talk about their situation and basically watch them fly around the runway and sit there and don't want to come to the point that the word of God is true, but all on the runway telling me about their particular situation. Oh no, but see, you don't understand my situation, pastor. See, my situation is like this and that. And keep me on the phone for 2 and 3 hours knowing good and well he got a beautiful wife sitting behind him and he got children. And they sitting at the dinner table. She's calling for her husband and the children are calling for their daddy. But he got to be on the phone listening to this person go on. And then his phone is constantly clicking from people who don't want a relationship with God, but they want the stuff. They want to have this season of reaping and they hoop and holler and they chase the prophets because they want to reap something that they have not sown. This is the reality of the church right now. How many of you have sown? And I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about just sowing, period. How many of you are doing good deeds for people that you see out on the street? And I'm not talking about your old drunk uncle and you bought him a beer. I'm not talking about you gave away a couple of shirts to your cousin. I'm talking about how many of you are out actually out being a minister. How many of you are sowing the word of God into the life of somebody else? How many of you are going out there and feeding the homeless and taking care of the poor? How many of you are even investing in the ministers that God has assigned to your life? You're too busy talking about them and criticizing them because you got a relationship with your money, yet and still you want to get the information that they have paid for in the fire. And I tell y'all, I'm going to tell you like this. God gives a minister half of the time has gone through the fire. They went through a trial and tribulation. They went through a lot of stuff. They paid for that information. And when they come out and they minister to you, you're saying, oh, I love you, I love you. But if they put it out in a book form, you roll in your eyes. I look on a lot of people's pages on Facebook, for example, and you'll see a man of God or woman of God advertising their new book. And normally, let's say, for example, this woman of God gets 236 likes on every status. When she advertises her book, she gets 40 likes and 10 sales. Why? Because half of the people want information that they didn't have to pay for, which is why they got to go through the storm to get that information. That information that she paid for is valuable. It teaches you to avoid the storm. But people say, well, why she don't just come out and give it to you for free? Because she had to pay for it. God, I'm going to tell you something. When you get in ministry, God will tell you what to put out, and he'll tell you what to put out and put a price tag on. I want y'all to understand that it's not a thing that people are selling the word. People are telling you about their experiences and the wisdom that they've learned. And when they come out and they're sharing that type of stuff with you, then if they put a price tag on it, if you need it, you better get it. I have a tendency, I invest in, for example, John Eckhart books because he has wisdom that I want to get. I invest in several books because there's wisdom in those books that I want to have, and I don't want to go through the fire to get to it. See, I don't have to go through the fire of trial. I've went through enough in my life, and I've come to understand I went through a lot because there was a time where I used to brag that I'm not a real big reader. I don't read that much. As a matter of fact, I was bragging about that probably even last year. I ain't a big reader. Oh, I bet you that changed within a year because I came to understand that I need that information. I can get so much information off a YouTube video. I can get so much information off an article. But whenever they go into the depths of the testimonies and stuff like that, I need that information. And because I need it, if it's in a book and he say $14.95 for that book, then I'm going to invest in that book because I need that information. I ain't going to sit there and complain about it. Half of the folks that sit back and complain keep going through all of these trials and tribulations. Why? Because you chosen to pay a different price for it. You're saying, I want to pay this price for my trial and tribulation. Okay, that's fine. That's your trial. That's your tribulation. You're going to come out with the same testimony. You're going to come out preaching fire. You know, when you go in through experience, you're going to come out breathing fire out your mouth, testifying. But if you want to get it another way, the fire can come out of you another way. All you got to do is go and get the information. If you want to reap a harvest, you got to sow. Y'all, like I said, I'm not talking about or not just talking about monetary. I'm talking about time. How many of you are volunteering at your local church? What are you doing? Are you just getting up, going to work, and coming home? You are sowing into your job, and you reap a paycheck. If you're hanging out with your family, you're sowing into your family, and they're going to reap Sunday dinner with you. You're getting paid for everything that you're doing. So what is it that you're sowing? People, like I said, people understand seasons when you talk about harvesting something. Everybody wants to go to a field and harvest what they have not sown. You're talking about, I want a husband, but what have you sown into receiving a husband? Do you keep your house clean? Are you paying your bills on time? What are you doing? Do you know how to cook? Are you getting your children, for those of you who have children, are your children in order? Or are your children running around the house screaming and crying and cutting up and cursing you out and tearing your house to pieces? And you asking God to send a man into that chaos? God requires order before he releases a blessing to the person who's requiring that blessing. He requires order. There must be a still. There must be peace. When you ask God for something, you got to be still to receive it. You got to do what he told you to do, but you got to be still. There has to be order in your life. If your children are running around the house, pulling the curtains down, screaming at each other, pulling knives on each other, then you're telling him that you're not ready. You can't even handle the life that you have. How dare you ask him for a man? You can't, and the same thing for you guys. How dare you ask him to send you a wife and talk about you want kids and you're not even taking care of the kids that you got? You got kids on the outside that you don't spend time with. Kids that you're not even trying to invest in. These children are crying out for you. They're calling on your name and they're getting bitter because you're not around. But you're sitting back and you're mad because a woman don't want nothing to do with you, or because she moved on with her life, and you call yourself trying to be better and you're taking it out on your kids. But you got the nerves to go to God and say, send me a wife. God's not going to send a woman into a situation like that. You got to be careful what you ask God for. When you ask God for something, make sure you're ready to receive it. Because you just can't ask him and say, I want these blessings and all of these great things that happen in my life and these wonderful things. But yet and still, God looks at your life and he sees your heart. There's chaos all around you. Chaos all filled within you. You can't ask God for that. You can't ask God for something that you're not ready for. If you can't take care of what you have now, you can't ask for more. If you're sitting back and you got a 500 square foot apartment and you can't keep it clean, then you shouldn't ask for a 1700 square foot home. You're not ready for it. You can't handle the one you got. And God said, I won't put more on you than you can bear. If you can't bear 500 feet, then you can't bear 1700 feet. That's real, y'all. I know some people get offended when you teach like this. They want you to come out and candy coat everything. I see people coming up and advertising. Oh, we're going to do this and that. Women getting drawn out to conference calls where they're telling you how to get a man. I got to teach you how to get a man in less than a year. Yeah, you're going to get an Ishmael in less than a year. People obviously don't understand seasons. So they're teaching you how to go against the seasons. And they're going to teach you how to go around the seasons. And I'm going to tell you something. There is no getting around them. So when you get off track, you're getting off track with God. When you go off over there and you listening to all that foolishness because you want a man more than you want God, you're going to step outside the will of God and say you're going to have plenty of Ishmaels waiting for you. Some of them are going to have insanity in their hand. Their assignment is to bring insanity in your life. Some of them are going to have disease in their hand. Their assignment is to disease your tail up. Some of them are going to have chaos in their hand. Their assignment is to bring chaos into your life and just rip everything away from you. Some of them are going to have death in their hand. Their assignment is to take your life. Satan's got plenty of people sitting up there and they're full of demons. And they got all of these strongholds. And the strong man is assigned to your life to take you out, to take out something that God has set aside for you. Or to keep you from getting something that God has set aside for you. For some of you, what you don't understand, for the ladies, some of the men who are sitting out there waiting, Satan has assigned them to rape your babies. I know I talked about this in the last thing, but I got to tell y'all the truth. Satan has assigned this man to come in and hurt your children, to break your children. But you keep trying to go around the word because you don't want to have to go through it. You don't want to have to go through what you got to go through. But I'm going to tell you, there is no shortcut to the promised land. You're going to have to go through the wilderness. You're going to have to go through. So it's up to you whether or not you spend 40 years in the wilderness or if you spend 7 days in the wilderness. It's up to you. Now, God has already set aside a season for everything. But what you need to do is make sure that you're in the right place, in the right mindset, so that you can go along with the seasons. That way you're not in a wrong place. So when a season of reap comes upon you, and it's going to come, and God says, okay, this is the season. Ordinarily, he should have been getting his wife, or ordinarily, she should have been getting her husband. But they've sown so much chaos and gossip and backbiting and slander and witchcraft that's what they're going to receive. And you spend a season, and sometimes y'all seasons can be years. You go through years and years of heartache and pain and depression and crying, and you can't understand why you're going through all that stuff. Whatever a man sowed, that is what he's going to reap. So I'm here to tell you, if you're asking, when is it going to be my season? The season is now. Your season is now. As of right now, you are reaping something or you're sowing something. What is it that you're sowing? What is it that you're reaping? Ask yourself that. I want to tell y'all before I go, take the time out and make sure you are sowing the right things. Make sure you are in the will of God and you go to building up on this relationship with God. And don't be so scared of the trials and tribulations that you got to go through. You know, like I said, some people, they say, I don't ask for patience. Shoot, I ask for it because I understand that without it, I can't get to the next season. I understand that without it, I'm not going to have understanding when a storm comes my way. So I'm not going to be patient enough to deal with that storm, which is going to intensify the level of that storm for me. And whereas other people may look at it and say it's a minor storm, I'll be swept all over the place losing my mind because I don't know how to deal with it. So I ask for patience. I ask for everything other folks are scared to ask for. I ask for wisdom, knowledge, understanding, patience, discernment. I ask for it all because I understand that those things are beneficial to my destiny. They're beneficial to my peace and me receiving the blessings of God. I don't want to sit back and tarry in a mindset and in a season for far longer than I should have had to tarry that thing simply because I was too scared to ask for something or simply because I was too scared to sow. I want to tell y'all, make sure you're sowing the right things in this season. Go out and sow the word of God into somebody else's life. You know, get out and sow the word of God into your own life. You know, get that word in you like never before. Sow into your pastors. The majority of you have a church that God has assigned you to. If God has assigned you to the man of God or the woman of God, sow into them. I'm not telling you, oh, go take care of folks on your bills. Having your bills are the way that they are. They're overwhelming you because you have a wrongful relationship with your money. You know, I'm going to tell y'all this before I go. A lot of pastors don't like to teach about money. A lot of pastors don't like to teach about finances because there has been such backlash in the church that, you know, we do have people who are thieves. We do have people who come out who, you know, they're all about the money. We do have the wolves who come out and it soured the sheep to the point that when the true shepherds come along, you're sitting back growling at the true shepherds. You're acting like a wolf yourself. You'd have been around the wolves for so long that you're starting to act like wolves yourselves. So you're sitting back and you're getting mad anytime a true shepherd comes along and they say, okay, the church needs money to stay open, which it does. You're sitting back growling at the pastor because you think it's his responsibility to pay for the church and to pay for the lights in the church and pay all those bills. And the only thing you're supposed to do is come in there and sit there because that's his Christian responsibility. What's yours? You know, we got to get to the point where we come to understand that anytime you go into a church building, that's not the pastor church. That building belongs to everybody who's coming to that church. Everybody who's coming in there. And one thing I say, if you got all the congregants and you got the church, and I think what a lot of pastors should do is say, okay, here are the bills. We're going to lay all the bills out. You know, the light bill, because some of them, like larger buildings or what have you, the light bill can be like $2,000, $3,000. The church building, which 9 times out of 10 is in a commercial area. So here is going to be a lot higher. So here is the bills for the church. So how about we put this out here and everybody divide up the bills and everybody divide up everything. And then at the same time, if you're wanting the pastor's time, how about you pay him for it? See, people get offended with that kind of stuff because you don't want to understand that if pastor can't be full time in ministry, he needs to go get a job. Okay, that's fine. He go get a job. If he goes and get a job, which is good for him to do. If he goes and get a job and he's working full time, he doesn't have time to impart wisdom, knowledge, and understanding to you. So you can't complain that you've been calling him for the last 3 weeks and he hasn't called you back because you don't understand that 25 other folks have been calling him too. We got to get an understanding that we can't sit there and keep sowing into these worldly musicians and into reality TV and all that foolishness and then getting an attitude when it comes to the church. I got to come out here and preach this to y'all because people don't want to hear this type of stuff. People got these wrongful relationships, but I'm telling you, God had to deliver me from that crap. So I got to come out and tell you how to be free from it. I'm not telling you to take my word. I'm telling you to take God at his word. Go in there and get on your own face and ask God. He'll tell you. Whatever he told me, he'll tell you. I'm confident in that. If you go and you ask God, he will tell you what your responsibility is. I tell people now, when I walk into a church, if I'm, you know, sitting in the midst of that church, the thing that I ask God is, how much do you want me to sow? That's the very thing I ask him. How much am I supposed to put in here? And I sit there and I praise and I worship and I trust that he's going to give me an answer before that envelope come around. When that envelope come around, I put in whatever he put on my heart. A lot of people don't ask God anything when it comes to giving. They ask God everything when it comes to receiving. When I'm going to get my husband? When I'm going to get me a new house? When I'm going to get money for a new car? You know that car got this problem, that car problem. God, I've been serving you for so long. I've been doing this. No, you've been going sitting at the table eating, but you haven't been putting nothing on the table. And like I said, I'm not just talking about money. I'm talking about time. You're not even sowing time in here. You're not sowing anything, but you're sitting at the table talking about, I want to receive. I want to receive. I'm hungry. I'm hungry. I need you. God says that whatever a man soweth, that he shall reap. So if you're not sowing anything, guess what? You're not going to reap anything. You can't just go into church and sow a bunch of words. That's why half of y'all keep reaping prophecies. You keep reaping words. You keep sowing words and you reap words. You sit up there and you're sowing, God, I honor you. God, I adore you. God, I love you. And you receive in return. God's going to send you this and God's going to send you that. And you'll be sitting there waiting for year after year. Because what God is doing is he's waiting on you to sow, to receive whatever that prophetic word was for you to get. He's waiting on you to get up and sow something into it. prophet came and prophesied into your life and you completely dishonored that prophet. Walked right away and had nothing to do. Won't even buy that man's book. Won't do nothing for that guy. Because you want somebody to come and bring everything. Because when it comes to Christ, you think everything's supposed to be given to you. Like I said, when I come out and preach like this, people don't want to hear because they want to hear how you get a man. And that's why half of these folks are going into these witchcraft churches. That's why these witchcraft churches are so full right now. People going into these witchcraft assemblies because you want to hear what you want to hear, but you don't want to hear the word of God. And I'm going to tell y'all, that is a bad place to be. It's to step before the living God on judgment day and say, haven't I prophesied in your name? And in your name, I cast out devils. And he said, get away from me, for I never knew you. Meaning you had no relationship with me. It was all about you and what you wanted. It was all about the stuff that you wanted. You worked so hard trying to get the stuff. You worked so hard trying to please people that God was on the back burner. And you thought he was going to accept that position when he was not. He's not. I'm going to tell you, I learned the hard way. God won't take the back seat. I'm telling you, I tried to put him there plenty of times. I put him in the back seat, turned around. He was gone. He said, I would never leave nor forsake you. I had to come to realize that, you know what? He didn't leave me. I left him. Because I went and I put him in a place that he was not going to accept. And I pulled off in my fantasies. I pulled off in the lies. And I sat there and I was hooping and hollering and rejoicing and excited about what the lies were going to do for me. All of these fantasies that the enemy played for me. And I thought were going to come to pass in my life. And I'm excited about this stuff. And I'm investing in everything that the devil told me he was going to give me. Because that's what I'm going to tell you. You invest in what you believe in every time. That's why half of you, when you're serving these worldly artists, you invest in them. You're going to always invest what you believe in. Every time. If you believe that you can get a man in your flesh, you're going to invest in a bunch of clothes, makeup, shoes. You're going to invest in that flesh of yours. You're going to invest in what you believe in. Pay attention to where your dollar's going and your time is going. That's going to tell you where you're going to reap. If you want to know where you're going to reap, pay attention to where you're putting your dollars and your time, not just where you're putting your prayers. Because I'm going to tell you something. I don't care how many times a person calls me up on the phone and tells me, you're such a wonderful girl and I love you and you're such a good friend. And I've had people like this in my life, y'all. You're such a good friend and I thank God for you and I was praying for you the other day. And we go out to eat and they don't never pick up the tab. Like they pick up the tab one time. But then every other time they got amnesia, when the tab come around, they sitting there looking all around or what have you, waiting on me to sit back and pick up the tab and I kick their tails to the curb. Why? Because they weren't my friends. They didn't have a relationship with me. They were wanting me to have a relationship with them and pour into them and be their friend and be all loving and take care of them. But when it came to me, they couldn't do it. See, I look at and I come to understand the relationship with God because God showed me through my own personal relationships how we do him. And one thing I've learned, if you come into my life and I'm sitting here and I take you out to eat and I spend, you know, money on, I'm not doing it for you to do it back, but I am going to pay attention when we go out to eat again. And we go out again. And every time we go out to eat, you sitting there trying to smile. Look, I don't care about how pretty your smile. It doesn't matter. If you're sitting there and you like, girl, I thank God for you. What have you? And I'm going to get you the next time. No. I'm going to walk away from you because you're trying to use me. I want y'all to understand you're doing the same thing with God. You're doing the same thing with God. You're always trying to make him pick up the tab. You're always trying to make him because you say he got more than me. So you don't understand. I've had people in my life. And that's why I came to understand that I had to learn the hard way that you can't just bring everybody into your life. Because if a person thinks that you have more money than them or more this or more that, they're going to make you sow more. You know, even if they think you got more wisdom than them, they're going to make you sow more. You know, they're going to have you pouring out and what have you. And you ain't going to get nothing in return. Or they're going to give you little bite-sized things in return. And you're going to be sitting there starving and hungry. And you being a better friend to them than they are to you. And all you're going to get in return is, I thank God for you. You are such a good friend. Oh my God, I love you. I was telling God the other day how much I appreciate. I don't want to hear all that. Show me that I'm a good friend. Show me that you appreciate me. You know, I tell people I had a friend back in Florida. I loved this woman and we're still friends to this day. This lady I met, and I met her while I was walking. And I went out to walk one day, and I met her. I had actually asked God. I was going through a divorce or what have you. And I asked God. I said, God, you know I don't need a lot of people in my life. You just send me one friend, and I'm good. I want one friend that's in my city. And I just want one person to hang out with. And I asked God, and I was out walking one day, and I came across this woman, and she looked at me. And I tell people, I was getting ready to put the headphones in my ear, because I always listen to Creflo Dollar or somebody when I start walking. And before the Creflo Dollar's haters come out, don't try me. But I sat back, and I was putting it, you know, in my ear so I can listen while I walk. And she waved to me, and then she gestured for me to come walking with her. And she became a really good friend. But we started going out to eat, and she was older than me, but you know, I felt that we were, you know, when it came to friends, we were on the same level. We understood that. I come to realize too, a lot of younger women, they don't understand friendship. They don't understand that friendship is something to be reciprocated. It's not something that you receive all the time and then you give good words and say, I thank God for you and all that other stuff. You know, people, it's the same thing we do with God. You, I thank you God for all your blessings. You're so merciful. And he's like, okay, homeless man over there corner, could you go help, please? Show me that you appreciate what I'm doing for you. But I started hanging out with this woman, and I go out to eat every weekend. That was my thing. Every Saturday, I go out to eat. I pick out a restaurant. I let God pick out a restaurant, and I go sitting there alone. So I told her about it, and she said, okay, I can come with you sometimes. And I would text her, like, whenever I was going to go. And, you know, for the most part, she would come, like, once a month or twice a month. She'll come with me to eat. And what would happen was I would sit there, and I'll get the tab. And she'll sit there. She's like, no. I said, I got it. She's like, I got it, Tiffany. I'll pay. And I said, nope. And I get it, and I get the tab or what have you. And she's just like, oh, man. And she covered her face. And I could tell that it kind of bothered her, because she's just like me in that area. You know, when somebody pick up a tab with me, sometimes I'm like, ah, you know. But that's just an area where God's still working on me with. But, you know, I sit back, and I slip it to the waitress, and I got it. And then she would tell me, well, I got you next time. And it became this thing that every weekend, anytime we went out, it was either I'm doing for her, or her doing for me. It was never one person doing more than the other. And it wasn't, you know, us keeping up with each other. It was more so whoever had the heart to do it at that moment. Because sometimes I didn't say nothing. It would be a time like she may have paid for the last time. Then we go out again and she like, I'm getting it today. Or when the waitress come out, she'll hurry up and hand them her card. I got it. Or what have you. And I'm like, I'm getting you next time. I've had plenty of friends, you know, in my life or what have you. But she was a rarity. And one thing I saw with her was that, like I said, she reciprocated. A lot of people don't reciprocate. What they do is they think that if I say something nice to you, or if I do one little thing nice for you, that's the equivalent, I tell you, of those little kids that, you know, you give them $5 every time you see them. One day they give you a chip and they think they didn't call it even when you haven't. But that's what people are doing to God. People are going to God and they're saying, I love you, I honor you, I worship and adore you. They're shedding tears all over the altar. But as soon as the pastor says, okay, here's an offering, they shut up and get offended, not understanding that the church doors need to stay open. You're requiring the pastor to take care of the church. This is the very thing that you need to come feed you wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. But you're trying to put that responsibility on the pastor. But yet and still, you get in your car and you pull off and you listening to these ungodly artists and you like, I got to go get her next CD. And you wondering why your life is like that. And you wondering why the pastor didn't stop answering your calls. Why? Because you still flying around and you have not yet come to that place where you can say the word of God is true. You got to get to that place. Season's going to play out like this. You're going to sow. Then you're going to wait. God's going to give you the opportunity to water others, and other people are going to come water you. You're going to be reciprocal. That's what, you know, how it goes. You're going to water others, and they're supposed to come and water you. Others are going to come water you. If you're letting people water you and you're not reciprocating, guess what? Your seed's going to choke, because ain't nobody going to come pour water on yours. So you can't expect God to bring an increase when you're a selfish creature. When you're sitting back and you're always wanting for yourself, you can't expect God to come and give you something that you have not sown. You're sitting back and you're sowing into self. I said they pray, but they pray amiss. They pray that they may consume it upon their own lust. That's what the equivalent of sowing is, without being willing to sow into somebody else. Without being willing to say, this is my sister, let me uplift her. This is my sister, let me spend some time with her. This is my brother. That's the equivalent. When you sitting there and you're like, well, I didn't sow my stuff, and you watching your sister drown over there. You're watching everything, and you over there like, well, I didn't do my part. Well, I mean, I did give her some encouraging words. Okay, that's what you're going to get. You're going to reap some words. You're going to reap a bunch of words, and you're going to sit there and you're going to wait month after month, year after year for those words to come to pass. Not to say that they're not going to come to pass. God's saying those words are going to come to pass as soon as you start sowing. And as soon as you start understanding that this ain't about you. When you come to the place where you start understanding that this is about us as a team, we are one, unified in Christ Jesus. We are all members of the body of Christ. So guess what? The hands need to help the feet sometimes, and the feet need to help the hands. Sometimes the hands got to scratch the head, but the head can't just sit there. The head's got to think and tell the hands what to do. The head's got to sit there and tell the hand, you know, don't touch that because it's too hot. Every part of the member has a relationship with another member. If your relationship is to yourself, then you're going to reap of your own flesh. Sometimes I can see why. I didn't understand it at one time when I used to go to church and you see like the pastor getting frustrated. I understand it now because there's so many misconceptions and mindsets in the body of Christ. You got a bunch of users who sitting up in the church who want to use God. And that's disgusting. They're sitting up in the church and they're just like, well, you know, I've been coming here for 12 years and you know what? They can probably count on one hand what you've done for the church. They can count on one hand how many people you've reached out to help. You've been so self-consumed that you don't even realize you're reaping of the very thing that you've sown. You keep sowing into self and you keep reaping of self. Now you're reaping every issue of your flesh. Your emotions are out of control. Everything's out of control because you keep sowing into death. What you need to be doing is sowing into something outside of yourself. You sow what God tells you to sow. Then you go over here and you water. God's going to call somebody else to come water you. Then you sit back and you wait. And you be patient. You encourage people. That's what you're doing. When you're encouraging others, you're watering your own seed. You'll notice that sometimes when you're ministering to others, it turns around and ministers to you. You're sitting there and you're watering your own seed. You take the time out and you stay faithful to God. When the temptation for you to think about having a husband and get frustrated about that comes upon you, you rebuke that thought and you go to God and say, obviously I need more time with you. And you go in there and you submit yourself to him some more, because you say, Lord, the temptation for me to cry over a man that I haven't met yet is there, and I don't want that. I need my relationship with you to be strong. Lord, help me in that area. Pull out this adultery. I renounce adultery in the name of Jesus. I don't want it no more, Lord. I surrender my heart and my mind to you. I'm right here, Lord God, change me. Instead of sitting there and fantasizing about this guy, and then you got tears flowing out your eyes, and you're like, I don't even understand. And then as soon as the devil see you like that, he said, I got you. And he said, look over here to the left. And you look over there, and Sister Sharon, for example, who's been fornicating and doing all this other stuff and got a man, and the devil uses that to tempt you into fornication. Now you're over here trying to hang out with Sister Sharon, even though God told you not to deal with this sister. You're supposed to restore her in meekness. You're not supposed to hang out with her. But instead of that, you doing the right thing, you try to be crafty, not understanding that God looks at your heart. Your mouth ain't having a conversation with him that's louder than what your heart's saying. Your heart is screaming out to God and telling God what's in it. So your heart is saying to God, I'm getting around Sister Sharon because I want to see if her man got a brother or a cousin or something like that, because her man fine and he doing real good. And I'm going to sit up here, and even though I'm going to go to the church and I'm going to hoop and holler and I'm going to try to deceive God, I'm going to sit back and I'm going to wait. And if he happens to have a man who's like him, I will fornicate because I'm tired of waiting. You know, your heart is sitting there saying, here are my idols. I want you to understand, your mouth is saying one thing, but your heart is saying another. What's your heart saying to God? Ask yourself that. What is your heart saying to God? Y'all, we got to get serious in this hour and stop playing with God. I tell you, I don't come out here to bash, blame, or condemn. I come out here to tell you in love, because I don't want my sisters and brothers going before God and being turned away because you didn't have a relationship with him. You had a relationship with your idea of what he is. One thing he told me is that a lot of people worship the image of him and not the reality of him. A lot of people are worshiping this idea of who he is. And they've crafted him in their mind according to their voids and their emotions to be this God who accepts them the way that they are. And they ain't got to change for him. He changes for them. They sit back and they say, he know my heart. And what they're doing is trying to make God conform to their beliefs. And they create this image, this idol that they begin to worship, and they call him by the name of the Lord. You know how wicked that is? They call this person who isn't really God, this image that they've created, this idol, they call him Jesus. And see, we got Jesus Christ. He is Lord. But this person that they've created in their head, this being that they've created, he is not the Lord. And they start worshiping this idea of who he is. They're worshiping this image. And that's why he's going to say, get away from me, for I never knew you. He's saying, you didn't have a relationship with me, even though you were prophesying and casting out devils. You didn't have no relationship with me. A lot of people are going to find themselves standing before God, getting turned away. And they've been in church all their life. I always say a lot of people are going to go to hell with their church shoes on. You know, they're going to be standing up there with their best wig on, going up there, whoo, hallelujah, running on up there to the Lord. Yes, Lord. Okay, what's my reward? And he looks at you and say, do I know you? I don't know you. Get away from me. I never knew you. Because you got this relationship with this image that you created. Look, the word of God is true. That's all I can tell you. The word of God is true. You can't get around it. You can't change it. You can't make it conform to your lust. You can't make it, you know, just do what you want it to do. You got to just accept it for what it is. The word of God is true. You got to die in all those areas. You may see 1,000 areas that you got to die in, and it looks overwhelming. But ask God to help you. He'll help you, and he'll help you throughout it. You just got to be willing. I've come to understand that God is willing to bless us, but we got to be willing too. It's our will that makes us look like him. Align your will with his will. Say, I'm willing to go through this process. I know it's going to hurt. I know I'm going to have to go through some stuff, but I'm willing because I want my father. I want my daddy. I want my everything. I want him to be pleased with me. And it is then that the seasons will start to play out in your life the way that you want to play out. Because the season of sowing is going to come and the season of reaping is going to come. But the question is, what are you going to reap? What have you been sowing? That's the question. Like I said, a lot of people, even with me, I see a lot of people come out, and I get one of the issues that I get with people is I tell people all the time, if you got a question, you know, if you want to ask me, ask Tiffany segment or something like that. Hey, look, do the free segment if you got to. Ask Tiffany when I get a chance. If I have time, I will come out and answer you via recording. You know, that's it. Or what have you. If you want a private answer, then I charge for a private answer because I cannot advertise that. You're saying to me, I don't want you to tell anybody else. I don't want this information to help anybody else. This is about me and me only. Okay, well, if you're doing that type of thing, then you pay for that. So for the free, I can come out and I can minister, and it's not just for you. It's going to help other people. So a lot of times people say, well, I don't want to go through this. So a lot of people, what they do is they do the very thing I say don't do. They call my business line and they say, am I talking to Tiffany? And y'all, I can't stand that. I hate it with an undying passion. Am I talking to Tiffany? And when I hear that, I know that's not a business call. Because my business customers, half of the time, they don't even know who I am. They don't know. All they know is that they want to order something. And that's it. And they go right on into, and then they start trying to get some advice. And they're sitting back and they're saying, basically, what I hear is I don't respect your system. I don't respect nothing. All I know is that I want to come to your table and eat. I ain't trying to sow nothing. I ain't trying to do nothing. I want to come to your table, sit here and eat. I want to waste your time because I'm circling the wrong way. I'm flying around and I don't want to understand that the word of God is true. So are you willing to sit here and waste your time on me? That's what I hear. See, I'm going to tell you, when a person is willing to change and ready to change, they'll sow into a change. They'll sow 50 cents or $50. It doesn't matter. They'll sow into a change. A person who's not willing to change, they don't want to pay for anything. Because they're afraid that you're going to give them information that they think is useless, which is you're going to have to land and come to realize that the word of God is true. They don't want to hear all that. They don't want to come to the conference calls. They don't want to do none of that because they want you to deal with them personally. They want you to tell them what they ought to do because they're looking for works. They're looking for you to tell them, hoop and holler and dance and go to this person. And I know a person in your city, go knock on his door. You got to knock on the back door and stomp your feet 3 times. And then he going to come to the door and he going to let you in and he's going to say a prayer over you. And that's going to make that man stop cheating on you. Or he's going to say a prayer over you and it's going to make them girls leave you alone. It doesn't work like that. You're looking for witches. It doesn't work like that. When you come to a man or woman of God, you better come at them the right way. You come and you honor the system. People come and they don't honor the man or woman of God because they don't honor God. They too busy trying to get around God. So they do his prophets and his teachers and his evangelists and his pastors and his apostles the same way. They come and they try to fly around and they try to sit back and play games. And you wonder why folks act like Judge Judy on you. And they sit back and they cut straight to the chase. Look, I don't want to hear all that stuff. We're not going to sit on this phone and go through all of the crap. What does the word of God say? That's the question. What does the word of God say? I don't need to hear that he's a good guy. Is he saved? Okay, end of discussion. What else do we need to talk about? If he's not saved, what else do we need to talk about? He's not saved. He's not serving God. So you're saying he's cheating and he's taking you through this. Okay, so what do we need to talk about? The word calls this man dark. So he's going to do the things of his father. So, you know, the Bible says don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. So what else do you want? You want God to rewrite the Bible and tell you that, well, here's what you got to do when you're dealing with an ungodly man. You know, if you choose to disobey God and get yourself an ungodly man, here's the new steps. You go out here and you sit there. And when he goes out and he starts doing what he is, ungodly things, when he goes out and he starts to mess with a neighbor, or he's out there, you know, selling drugs or slapping folks around and doing all kinds of crazy stuff, all you have to do is be at home and take a raw chicken bone and throw it out the window and wrap it up in dirt and bring it back in the house and then slap it around a couple of times and then baptize that chicken in some perfume. You want witchcraft. I tell you, a lot of people don't even realize that's what they're asking for. You want witchcraft. You want to force somebody to go against their will. God does not go against the will of another human being. God will allow you to do what you want to do. That way, when you come before him, you can't blame him for nothing. When you come before him, you had a choice. You chose that life that you lived. When you come before him, it's your fault. None of God's fault. You can't place the blame on him at all. So he doesn't go against your will. It is called witchcraft to go against the will of another human being. So even though you may be in Christ and that man may not be in Christ and he out doing ungodly things, it is against the will of God. It is witchcraft for you to go and try to force that man to do what he doesn't want to do. Only thing you can do when an ungodly man is tell him what you want. I want you to be faithful to me. I want you to go to church. I want you to have a relationship with God. I want you to be a good father to your children. And if he chooses to do otherwise, then it's your choice. Ball's in your court. You choose what to do with this man. You know, I always tell women when they call me up about their husbands or boyfriends and these guys are doing all kinds of crap to them, I always tell them, ball in your court. You know, the thing is, you say, what do you want? I want him to stop cheating. He don't want to stop cheating. So what do you want? I want you. God's not going to go against this man's will. You can pray. You can go to 256 witches. And I'm going to tell y'all what a witch going to do. A witch will give you some stuff that'll try to cripple that man's will. But it's going to start breaking him down. It's going to break your house down. It's going to attack your children, attack your finances, attack your relationship. And then that enemy, a lot of times he'll take that man's life or he'll take one of your children's life because you're over here playing with witchcraft. And the enemy likes blood as an offering. Whenever you ask him for something, a lot of times he wants something back in return. And Satan's not interested in money and things. He likes blood. He likes death. He wants to take a soul. So when you go over here, and I want y'all to understand this, for those of you who are so, you know, stuck on your ways, when you go out here and you marry or get into a relationship with an ungodly man, then there's a price for that ungodly man because you're entering a relationship where basically there are demons present. You're entering a relationship with not only that man, but his demons. And then you go into that relationship with this man and you're basically having an argument with his demons and trying to tell them how to act like angels. And you're yelling at them, oh, you got to stop doing this. They're demons. You know, this man needs deliverance and he chooses the sin that he's in. So you're sitting back here and you're wasting your time hooping and hollering and yelling and screaming and flipping all upside down, kicking this man and doing everything that you can trying to make this man be who he is not or who he doesn't want to be. And you're wasting your time because you're still circling the wrong way. You have not landed at the word of God is true. You should not be unequally yoked with an unbeliever. And you sit there and you do all of that stuff trying to force that man to be what you want him to be, which means guess what you end up doing? Stepping into witchcraft, even from within the church. A lot of people do that. A lot of people go into church and they go around these witches and they even become witches themselves, not even knowing that they're witches, sitting up there getting into witchcraft, trying to force another human being to be what they want them to be. And that's outside the will of God. And you sit there and wonder why you're under attack, because you over there, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to help you to understand how you become when you get in this situation. I want you to see this. You step into Satan's house, which is Satan's will. You step into Satan's will and you start screaming the name of Jesus from within his home. But he got rights over there. He got his license and he's doing everything. And you up in his house screaming out the name of Jesus. But yet still you serving him, eating his food, doing all his other stuff. But yet still you get up and go to church and you screaming out the name of Jesus. And you wondering why he wearing your tail out. All them demons get up from the table and beat the mess out of you. And you wondering why the Lord won't come and rescue you because you're not in his will. His will is his home. You're not in his will. The word of God is true. Until you land there, you're going to go through some stuff. You're going to circle the runway. You're going to find ministers. Y'all, I want you to get there. So I'm going to go ahead and end this call now, but I want to say this. Even if you think you're in forgiveness, come on to the conference call tomorrow. A lot of people, like I said, when it comes to when you do talks that are not about a man or about a woman, they don't want to come out to that kind of stuff. And it can be the very thing that you needed to get you free so that you can receive that husband. Because the problem could be that you're in unforgiveness and you don't know it. There is a such thing called false humility. I found myself in it at one time, didn't know I was there until the Lord had me to shut down everything 24 hours, do a fast, and then he revealed that I was in false humility. The man that I was going through a divorce with at that time, I had unforgiveness in me toward him. And I didn't know that it was there because I was saying all the right things and I was forcing myself to think all the right things. But God had to bring me back to what I really believed. And he had to bring me back to what was really in my heart. I had to confess it and then he delivered me from it. And I had to sit back and wage war against the enemy to keep my peace and to hold on to my forgiveness. So y'all make sure you come out to that conference call. Like I said, if you haven't purchased anything from Cellfi, this is going to be a recorded call. So, you know, go to Cellfi, make sure you get something so that you can get the email and you can be on the conference call. I really want to see you there. It's going to be a powerful call. It's going to really bless you. So, you know, if you know people that need to come onto the call, make sure you encourage them. Like I said, just go to Cellfi, get something. I don't care if it's 99 cents. I just released a rejection series. It's about 7 hours of teaching. It's really, really powerful. You know, you can go on there and get that. It's my newest release. It's got a lot of different things to it. I've already talked about it. I've already advertised it. A few of you have already bought it. But I want to tell you, the rejection series is really going to help you with forgiveness as well. Because a lot of problems that start with forgiveness, or a lot of people who deal with forgiveness, it's not just the forgiveness. Rejection is the foundation for the unforgiveness. And some people, you know, unforgiveness is the foundation for their rejection. So come out to the call tomorrow. It's going to be powerful. It's going to be an hour long teaching. And then after that, I'm going to open up the floor for questions. I want to see you there. Like I said, make sure you get one of the teachings. Even if you go in there and get a 99 cent teaching, it doesn't matter. That way I have you on my email list forever. I'm going to be having public calls as well, where you don't have to buy anything to come on these calls. And like I said, these calls likely won't be recorded. Or if I do record them, 9 times out of 10, I'm not going to be distributing them. So if I'm going to distribute something, I have to be careful, because I've had cases where I couldn't distribute things because of the amount of interference that was on the line. And that's not what I want. So I'm hoping to see y'all on the line. We're going to come against the enemy. We're going to talk about unforgiveness. And y'all are going to be amazed at how unforgiveness has affected so many people's debt. So if you're suffering with poverty or what have you, get on that line. I'm going to tell you right now. If you are suffering in your finances, get on that line. God has given me a lot of revelation, and I can't wait to release it to you. The information is in the comment section for the revelation teaching and all that. Also, don't forget, I'm having a remnant writers class. If God has put a book in your belly, I'll put the information in the section. We're going to be having a class starting September 19th. I'm allowing 20 students to come into the class. We've already got 5 students who've signed up so far. So I'm going to have about 15 more seats left. I haven't advertised it real heavy, but when I start advertising it real heavy, the seats tend to fill up really fast. So make sure you click the link in the comments. If you're writing a book, or if you need help writing your book, I'm going to pull that book out of you in 5 weeks or less. It is pretty intensive, but at the same time, most of my students, I can honestly say 98-99% of my students, they love the class. Everybody who's ever come out to these classes, they love the class. God allowed me to pull those babies out of them. They wrote their books and what have you. And a lot of people are authors now, and I'm the auntie to so many books. So anyhow, hope to see you in the Remnant Writers class. Definitely hope to see you on tomorrow's call. I really want to talk to you. Like I said, last call, we had 164 callers. This call, I don't know how many are coming out. I'm going to make sure I send an email out to those of you who are already signed up. So check your emails. For those of you who didn't get the email last time, check your spam folder. You know, make sure you look through that spam folder and see if you're getting any emails from Anointed Fire. Do a search in your computer and make sure you register my email address. You'll find it on my website. You'll find it on anointedfire.com. As a matter of fact, make sure you register my email address so that you can receive the emails, you know, in your email box and you won't miss them. If you've registered before through Sellfire, if you purchase anything and you didn't get information for the last call and you search your computer and you still don't see the information, then email me and let me know. That way I can do a search on your email address and make sure that it's in the system. Look, check your email first, y'all. Don't just start reaching out and sending me emails, because I don't want to get bombarded with a bunch of emails and I end up having a bunch of work to do. Anyhow, tomorrow's call starts at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It's going to last for about an hour. I'm looking forward to it. I know it's going to be powerful. And I'm hoping y'all come out. I love you. And I hope this message blessed you and God bless you.